My name is Jake Schmidt, and I'm a member of the Dole Institute's Student Advisory Board. Welcome to the Dole Institute of Politics. The Dole Student Advisory Board is composed of KU students committed to the bipartisan mission of the Dole Institute. Members of the SAB receive many great opportunities. If you are a student and would like to join, please contact the Dole Institute. If at any time during the program you have difficulty hearing, please alert one of our staff members or student volunteers. Before we begin tonight, I'd like to remind you to please turn off your cell phones. After the interview, we will have some time for audience question and answers. If you have a question, please raise your hand, and a student helper with a microphone will come to you. Please stand if you are able and just ask just one brief question. And now, please welcome Associate Director of the Dole Institute, Dr. Barbara Ballard.
Thank you, Jake. Fine job. Well, good evening again, and I will echo brave souls. And welcome to the Dole Institute of Politics, part two of this year's presidential lecture series, They Almost Ran, America's Would-Be Presidents. But before I continue with the rest of the introduction, I would just like to cover the weather a little bit. Woo, turn your phones off.
I haven't. So, I was turning it on.
Our guest, yes.
That was the only reason why I said that. Okay, I would say to you, if we hear sirens, the first thing will happen is that Bill Lacey, director, will suspend the program immediately. For those of you who do not need assistance in wheelchairs or anything like that, you will go through that exit. Just please look and see the exit. You'll go right through that door there. Clara, please stand by that door to make sure they understand that's the door. Open it for those people who haven't done so, yes. And you will follow two sets of steps down there and you will end up in the hallway.
And you want to make sure that you go in door number one. You don't want door number two or door number three. Make the right choice.
All right. And you go all the way down, and you will be in the hallway. Actually, it's one of the safest places in town because you will be right in the middle of the archive in the hallway along those lines. If you're in a wheelchair and you need assistance, I will be watching that. And if I don't see lightning or no one else does, we will take you straight to the back, go through the elevator quickly, and go downstairs. If not, there will be between the staff, the students, and I, we will make sure that you get downstairs. Okay? Everybody got it? I hope we don't need it. Okay? But I wanted to make sure that we did cover that. And this evening, we will have two of our guests, and we're just delighted. And I see that Judge Joyce Alexander Ford is just coming in because she had her discussion group today. And her guest was Judge Thelma White Cummings Moore from Georgia. And they went out to dinner because they didn't leave until 5:45. So she is coming in. So I would just like to acknowledge her this evening. With that, I will go on with our introduction. This event, as you all know if you were here last night, is the fourth in the four-part series. And tonight's program will cover Bob Dole, Hubert Humphrey, and George McGovern. Tonight's interview will be conducted by Dole Institute Director Bill Lacey. And tonight's guest has a long-standing relationship to the Dole Institute, as many of you know. In addition to serving as the Institute's first permanent director, he has delivered many outstanding lectures on presidential histories and politics. He must have, because in fear of your life, you're still here this night. So I want to say that. So currently a distinguished presidential scholar at Grand Valley State University, he has served as director for a host of renowned institutions, including the presidential libraries of Herbert Hoover, Ronald Reagan, Gerald R. Ford, and Abraham Lincoln. He is a frequent contributor to outlets such as Time, the New York Times, C-SPAN, and PBS NewsHour. It is always a pleasure for us to have Richard Norton Smith here at the Dole Institute of Politics, and I would ask you to please give one of the nation's foremost presidential scholars a welcome, Richard Norton Smith.
Richard, we have three fascinating figures to cover tonight. We won't be able to spend as much time as I would like or all of you would like on each one of them, but we'll make sure we allow questions at the end so you can follow up on anything that you feel I don't cover. Let's start with the happy warrior, Hubert Humphrey. Introduce us to Senator Humphrey and how he eventually would become one of the most influential figures in the Democratic Party.
Well, there's something particularly appropriate about the weather this evening. Senator Humphrey, who was famously loquacious, was once described by Barry Goldwater as speaking 250 words per minute with gusts to 350. But people listened when Hubert Humphrey spoke, as well they might. It's interesting, Humphrey and McGovern have so much in common. They were both born in South Dakota. They both taught Senator McGovern history and Senator Humphrey political science. Humphrey went into his father's pharmacy business originally, but I don't think he really ever intended to stay there. Politics drew him at an early age. He worked in several New Deal agencies in the 1930s. He, during the war, tried on three occasions, in fact, to enlist and was turned down for health reasons. In fact, jump ahead, in 1960, there was a famous incident in the West Virginia primary in which Franklin Roosevelt Jr. was enlisted on behalf of the Kennedys to raise questions about Hubert Humphrey's wartime record. It was attributed to Bobby, who could be pretty ruthless as a campaign manager, and it certainly did not contribute to good feelings between Humphrey and the Kennedys. Humphrey ran for mayor of Minneapolis, I think for the first time in 1943, was defeated. He was also, along with Senator McGovern, we're looking at two men who were party builders. McGovern almost single-handedly built a Democratic Party in South Dakota. Hubert Humphrey presided over the creation of Minnesota's Democratic Farmer Labor Party, the DFL, which was a left-of-center, agrarian-based, and for many years, a very dominant force in Minnesota. Eventually, he was elected mayor of Minneapolis, and it was as mayor of Minneapolis that he really came to national attention for the first time in 1948 at the Democratic Convention. Harry Truman did not want to really rock the boat on the issue of civil rights, fearing a Southern walkout. And if you all remember, Truman was starting out far enough behind at that point. The last thing he wanted to do was to further divide his party. Humphrey, on the other hand, insisted, as he said to the delegates, that it was time to get out of the shadow of states' rights and to walk into the bright sunlight of civil rights. And they managed to carry a strong civil rights plank, which in turn led to the walkout of Strom Thurmond and other Dixiecrats who formed their own Southern States' Rights Party in 1948. But it was an important way station in the reshaping, if you will, of the modern Democratic Party. Also, very important, when a small group of communists tried to, in effect, infiltrate the DFL, Humphrey led the fight against them, and in fact, he was one of the co-founders of Americans for Democratic Action, which were New Deal liberals who were vehemently anti-communist, if you will, Cold War liberals. That was the original basis for ADA. In 1948, he was elected to the Senate. He would serve several terms, well, until Lyndon Johnson chose him to be his vice presidential running mate. He ran for president in 1960. As he said, it was a mom-and-pop operation against the Kennedys' sleek supermarket. Give you an idea, Hubert Humphrey never had money. And you had the sense that his whole career was spent in some ways panhandling so that he could he could run for president. In a single primary in 1960, West Virginia, he spent $23,000. And the best estimates are the Kennedy spent $1.5 million. Guess who won? In any event, in 19—Humphrey was also a premier legislator. He was really the leader on the 1964 Civil Rights Act, which was, if you stop to think about it, a natural sequel to that speech he had made in 1948, committing the Democratic Party to the cause of civil rights. He was also, as you might expect, being from Minnesota, a great champion of farm programs, of agriculture generally. He was forever proclaiming that dairy price supports needed to be raised. Senator Dole used to have a running gag with him, mocking both his loquaciousness and his support for dairy interests. Humphrey would get going on one of these harangues in committee, and the Senator Dole would have secreted a glass of milk under he got out and say, "Here, Hubert, wet your whistle." And it's interesting that Humphrey and Dole became very good friends, just as Dole and McGovern became very good friends. Some of it grounded in their shared interests of agricultural advocacy, but much more in the kinds of people they were and the fact that they were all products of the prairie. And they all had, each in his own way, I think, a streak of the populist. Humphrey achieved the vice presidency, and I think only to be one of the more unhappy vice presidents in American history. Early on, he voiced some dissatisfaction, for example, over our policies in Vietnam, and LBJ shut him out. The story literally took away his pencils. I mean, can you imagine being Lyndon Johnson's vice president? It would not be fun. And of course, it came to a head in 1968. In that tumultuous year, first Gene McCarthy ran on an anti-Vietnam War platform. Johnson pulls out at the end of March. Dr. Martin Luther King is murdered a week later. Bobby Kennedy gets into the race. He's murdered in June. And then you have, in effect, the Johnson forces, the establishment, if you will, in the Democratic Party, which rallies around the vice president, Hubert Humphrey. Humphrey famously talked about the politics of joy. He was the happy warrior. There wasn't a lot of joy in America in 1968. And ironically, again, at what should have been the greatest moment of his life, the night that he won the Democratic nomination in Chicago, it was forever marred by the riots and the, many people believed, police overreaction in the streets of Chicago. On TV, probably costing Humphrey the election in November, because it really came to symbolize what millions of people felt at that point, that the country was coming apart at the seams.
Yeah, talk a little bit about the general election in 68 and what transpired and ultimately why, in addition to that, you thought that Humphrey lost.
And of course, it's also the year that McGovern came onto the scene in 68. 68, of course, was a tumultuous year, the year of Vietnam. The anti-war movement had grown exponentially, certainly in the Democratic Party, less so in the Republican Party. Johnson fatigue was profoundly felt. But more than that, this was a country that in many ways was catching up. There was tumult before there was triumph. The civil rights movement, which we look back on now, I think almost universally, with great pride, was a polarizing force for many people. It split the Democratic Party. 1968, you had a third party with George Wallace, the openly segregationist governor of Alabama, who peeled off a lot of Democratic votes, working class votes, union members, and the like. You had Vietnam further splitting the country and certainly the Democratic Party. You had the challenge of Bobby Kennedy to reestablish, in effect, the legitimacy of the presidency, which some Kennedy admirers had never ceded to LBJ. So you had all of this coming together, and poor Hubert Humphrey, who in another year would have been the candidate of the left, the New Deal left, and probably an anti-war candidate at that, nevertheless was required by the job that he held and by the president for whom he worked. Johnson might not have been able to get elected himself, but Johnson could decide who would be nominated at the Democratic Convention. And so Humphrey found himself in this terribly awkward position. It's always difficult for a vice president running for the presidency to establish his independence. How do you do it without appearing disloyal to your boss? There's a reason why we don't, as a rule, elect sitting vice presidents. So as the fall campaign played out, Richard Nixon very skillfully tapped into the issue law and order. Now, some people read that as coded racism, but many people felt that, in fact, it was also a reference to this sense that many people had that the rug was being pulled out from under, quote, traditional values, the family structure, the women's movement. All of these revolutionary forces were coming into play in one year, in addition to the dissatisfaction caused by the war, the horror of the assassinations, the riots that followed the assassination, particularly of Dr. King. And so the remarkable thing is Humphrey started out the campaign 20 points behind. And he had no money. And it was a totally different, that's very important, we had a totally different campaign. We had no campaign finance system. Basically, candidates were free to raise money wherever they could. Nixon had a substantial advantage. Humphrey once again found himself almost broke and having to spend a lot of his time all but panhandling to buy TV time. There was no public financing, certainly, of elections. So you had all of these factors working against him. And the single biggest test before the election was over was how or if he could establish some degree of independence from LBJ. And of course, that meant Vietnam. And in Salt Lake City, on September 30th, he gave a televised address in which he said that he would be willing, as a risk for peace, to stop the American bombing of North Vietnam. Johnson wasn't happy, but from that point, the race began to turn around. And on election night, Humphrey lost by less than a percentage point. It was a remarkable comeback. He was out of a job. He went back to Minnesota, taught again at McAllister College. In 1970, was returned to the Senate, taking the seat vacated voluntarily by Eugene McCarthy. He returned to the Senate, reestablished himself as the classic sort of face of New Deal liberalism, ran in 72 again, this time was defeated by his old friend and fellow Prairie liberal, George McGovern. And indeed, in 1976, was urged by many to throw his hat in the ring against Jimmy Carter. But he had been diagnosed with terminal bladder cancer. And then something really remarkable happened. Politics went out the door, and he was invited. He's to this day the only American, other than a president, to address the House of Representatives, the only member of the Senate ever to do so. Honors were showered on him. He called Richard Nixon, his old nemesis, to invite him to his funeral. And Nixon, of course, was in disgrace following his resignation. Ironically, it was Hubert Humphrey who gave Richard Nixon the bridge. It was the first time Nixon returned to Washington. It was for Hubert Humphrey's funeral in 1978. One other story. Humphrey didn't run against Carter, but he may not have voted for him either. President Ford, who was a good friend of his, went to visit him in the hospital in the last couple weeks of the 76 campaign. And Humphrey was really in pretty bad shape. But they said he would go around the hospital rooms cracking jokes and entertaining, you know, and befriending other patients. I mean, just an extraordinarily courageous character. Anyway, they had a nice talk. And Humphrey said, with a big smile on his face, "Well, Jerry, you're going to be getting some votes out of the Humphrey household." He didn't say more, but in any event, when he died, I think it's safe to say a certain kind of politics died with him. And certainly the New Deal liberalism lost its greatest champion, although Ted Kennedy in some ways inherited that mantle.
Right. Take a moment to tell us about Humphrey's political legacy.
Well, he certainly insisted that the Democratic Party live up to many of its promises. He, at a very early point in time, insisted that whatever the political risk, there was a moral compulsion to embrace civil rights. He believed that government had a moral and not just economic obligation. One of the last pieces of legislation passed in his life was called the Humphrey Hawkins Act. Today it would be almost unimaginable, but it mandated that if unemployment reached a certain rate, then the federal government would step in and provide jobs, you know, a certain number of jobs. I mean, it was classic Humphrey liberalism. But I think in some ways, he was a great legislator. But ultimately, I think it was the quality of the man, his character, his joy, his insistence on an optimistic view of life and on working with people across the aisle. I mean, he and Dole became genuinely very good friends. After the 76 race, I remember the senator telling me that one of the first calls he got was from Humphrey. And if you remember, Dole was taking some pretty harsh criticism for his alleged role in Ford's defeat. And Humphrey said, "Bob, you know, don't listen to the critics. I know exactly what you're going through. You did exactly what you were, you know, asked to do. And you couldn't have done it better." And, you know, needless to say, it's at times like that, as Dole was, that's when you find out who your friends are. In a town like Washington, where criticism is constant and cheap, it's at moments like that when you discover who you want to be in a foxhole with. And Hubert Humphrey I think, one of Dole's favorite people. It's interesting, in Dole's last speech, his farewell to the Senate in 1996, before the Republican convention, I think it's safe to say there were those on the campaign who wanted him to use the occasion to drive a few wedges in the electorate. And instead, he talked about the people, particularly Humphrey and McGovern, with whom he had been able to work over the years, implying that, you know, that was the kind of president he would be, but also just paying tribute in a very personal way.
Let's move along to our next subject, Senator George McGovern. Talk a little bit about his background and his service in the United States Senate.
Well, yeah, again, native of South Dakota, trained for the ministry early. His father was a Methodist minister, and McGovern had that in mind. But he went off to war, and of course, one of the great mysteries of the 72 campaign was how little was made of McGovern's extraordinary war record.
That was my first campaign in college. I had no clue the guy had been a bomber.
And the great irony was McGovern was written off as a peacenik, you know, an appeaser, and all of this. This was a man who had who won the Distinguished Flying Cross, among other honors, who had flown 35 missions over Nazi-occupied Europe, everyone obviously putting his life at risk, and hundreds more. But he never exploited it, never talked about it, which does, quite frankly, raise questions about his political judgment. You know, not his character, on the contrary, but Senator Dole, for a long time, was very reluctant to talk about his wartime experiences. And I have since discovered, by talking to enough of his contemporaries, that's not unusual. There are a great many people who came through World War II, and I'm sure other conflicts as well, Vietnam more recently, who are very reticent about reliving, in effect, what may have been a pretty horrific experience. But in Dole's case, and I'm sure it was the same thing with McGovern, they didn't want to appear to be exploiting those experiences for political gain. So in any event, McGovern abandoned thoughts of the ministry, although there would always be that moralistic, and I use that in a positive way, the kind of Wilsonian, Stevensonian approach to politics. He taught, as I said, he taught history, and in the 1950s, well, he voted for Thomas Dewey. His parents were both Republicans, and everyone in South Dakota was in those days. And he voted for Dewey against Roosevelt in 44. In 48, he supported Henry Wallace of the Progressive Party, although he became distressed by what he saw as communist influence in the Progressive Party movement. And in 1952, he fell madly for Adlai. In fact, when he and Eleanor, his wife, had their first son, they named him Stephen. Stephen's son. He became a confirmed Stevensonian Democrat. There was no Democratic Party. At that point, the South Dakota legislature had 110 Republicans and 2 Democrats. And he built it from scratch. You may have had the title of executive secretary or something, but literally going around the state, filling out note cards, building an organization, and eventually was elected to the House, and then after a failed attempt in 1960, JFK made him the first director of Food for Peace, which turned out to be prescient in a lot of ways. And in 1962, on his second try, he was very narrowly elected to the United States Senate, a Democratic senator from South Dakota, which was really unheard of. And he would stay for three terms until 1980, when he was defeated in the Reagan landslide. But in 1963, his first year in Washington, he became the first senator to raise questions about Vietnam. And that really would become the issue more than any that defined that, and of course, the work that he did on nutrition, on agriculture generally, on picking up off of the work of Food for Peace and the like, and continuing long after he left the Senate. For example, he and Senator Dole working together on a global.
Mm-hmm. Receiving the World Food Prize, so.
Absolutely. So anyway, but in 1968, his good friend Bobby Kennedy was killed, and McGovern was torn. At the last minute, he entered the race. He got 170 delegates or so at the convention, just as a place for Bobby Kennedy's supporters who could not bring themselves to vote for Gene McCarthy or Humphrey, you know, to go. And then came the most, in some ways, the greatest influence of George McGovern's career, and a huge influence literally to this very night. George McGovern is more responsible than anyone else for how we choose our presidential candidates, because something called the McGovern-Fraser Commission was created ostensibly to re-examine within the Democratic Party the system of nominating candidates. This was after 1968 and the riots and poor Hubert Humphrey's defeat. And sure enough, the result of the McGovern-Fraser Commission was twofold. One, it greatly increased the number of primaries and caucuses. In other words, it took it out of the smoke-filled rooms. And two, it led to George McGovern's nomination in 1972. That was a revolution. That convention, if you remember the 72 convention, in 68 the riot was outside the hall, in 72 it was inside the hall. For example, Mayor Daley of Chicago was kicked out of the convention of the Democratic Party and replaced by a delegation led by Reverend Jesse Jackson. Reformers replaced regulars, and it was a traumatic, in some ways, experience. It was also a convention not run very well. Famously, the last night when the candidate gives his acceptance speech, they had a total breakdown of discipline. 25 or 30 people were nominated for vice president, including Walter Cronkite, and I think Mickey Mouse got a couple of votes. And with the result, Senator McGovern's excellent acceptance speech was delivered at 3 o'clock in the morning to a greatly reduced audience. And that, in some ways, was a forerunner of the whole campaign. He was running against Richard Nixon at a time when Nixon was coming off of the twin triumphs of the opening of China and Russia. The economy was doing fine. The Vietnam War was, for all intensive purposes, over as far as any combat role for American troops. McGovern was easy to portray as a radical. Remember last night I talked about how it was Barry Goldwater's Republican opponents who had tagged him with that label in the primaries. Well, Hubert Humphrey and the other Democrats who ran against McGovern had performed the same function. All Nixon had to do was quote them or show clips of them. So McGovern started out way behind, and then he had a disaster. He had picked Senator Thomas Eagleton of Missouri to be his running mate, hadn't vetted the nomination. In those days, you picked a VP at 3 o'clock in the morning after you got your nomination, and you crossed your fingers and hoped like hell that he wouldn't embarrass you. And Senator Eagleton was not altogether forthcoming when asked if there was anything in his background that might cause problems. Well, sure enough, 10 days or so after the nomination, it was revealed that he had received electroshock treatment for depression, which 40 years ago was not certainly seen in the light that it would be today. And there was no question of Eagleton staying on the ticket. He should, by rights, have withdrawn. He didn't, and Senator McGovern made it infinitely worse by saying famously that I'm 1,000% behind Tom Eagleton. Well, even as he said that, he obviously was hoping that Eagleton would take the hint. And anyway, it all played out in front of the cameras, and it confirmed the impression of Senator McGovern as someone who was, in effect, not ready for prime time. Then he couldn't get anyone to run with him. Once Eagleton did leave the ticket, Senator Kennedy turned him down. A number of other people did as well. And in the end, Sergeant Shriver agreed to run, but it was really a doomed campaign. But the great moment, and I suspect I'm asking Senator McGovern about this, and I think he probably is certainly one of the few moments in that whole campaign that he enjoyed. The last weekend of the campaign, he knew he was going to lose, and lose badly. And he was heckled by some Nixon supporters. And they were at a airport, and these were people, you know, on the fence. And so he motioned for one of them to you know, come up to him. The guy, you know, didn't know what to do, but how often do you get asked to, you know? So anyway, he walked up and he said yes, and McGovern leaned over and he said, "Kiss my ass." Which was, you know, we almost had Kevin White for vice president in 1972. The mayor of Boston, one of my bosses, the great mercurial mayor of Boston, who for about 3 hours was on the ticket with McGovern until Senator Kennedy and other members of the Massachusetts delegation passed the word that that would not be acceptable. And McGovern had to call the mayor back and say the offer was withdrawn. And that's what led to Senator Eagleton.
Talk about Senator McGovern's career after the 72 election and what his legacy is.
Yeah, well, he remained in the Senate till 1980. A strong opponent of the war, of course. As the country moved right, in anticipation of 1980, he knew he was going to have a tough fight on his hands for re-election. And in the end, he was defeated, 61-39. And then something really interesting happened. He discovered the private sector. It's funny, he bought a hotel. He and Mrs. McGovern sank their earnings into this business, and they tried to make a go of it, and through no fault of their own, after about a year and a half, it failed. And McGovern came away from the experience. He said, "I wish I had known more about what businessmen actually have to put up with." He said, "The excessive regulation that government imposed on small business owners made it impossible for them to profit at this venture. And it opened his eyes in a way. I mean, he was always, he was never the wild-eyed radical that he was portrayed. He was from South Dakota, which meant, he believed in balanced budgets and certainly was always raising questions about the defense budget, but not just the defense budget. But anyway, and then in his later years, he basically supported himself through speaking fees, and he became, he'd always been theoretically friendly to private enterprise, but I think it became much more personal. But he did have, I will tell a story, which I've never told before. A number of years ago, if you remember, Governor Kerwin became archivist of the United States. Before that happened, we had another candidate. The presidential libraries are periodically under attack, either from people in Congress or from other parts of the archives who resent our visibility and success. And the Office of Archivist was vacant. And we've gone through, God, I was actually approached. God, thank God for once in my life. I had the sense to say no. Horrible job. But we were going through, and then I thought, I've got it. I have the perfect candidate. And as it just so happened, he was going to be participating in a conference that we had organized at one of the libraries. I think I was at the Reagan Library then. Anyway, Senator McGovern, who, remember, among other parts of his legacy, had brought a whole generation of young people, including Bill and Hillary Clinton, into the political process. Bill Clinton ran the state of Texas. Can you imagine what a welcome test that was, running Texas for George McGovern in 1972? But in any event, and McGovern had taught history. What a wonderful choice. And I remember going to him and I said, would you consider this? And he thought about it. But I think at that point, frankly, he needed to make some money. And I also think at that point, he'd probably had his fill of government. And unfortunately, he turned us down. And the upshot of that was, we went to Governor Kerwin. But in any event, I got to know McGovern in his later years, and he, just the most decent, honorable, and there's a wonderful, well, I'll tell you one other story, quick, wonderful story. When Pat Nixon died in June of 1993, I was invited to the funeral. There were about 350 of us. If you've been to the Nixon Library, it was outdoors. And afterwards, everyone was invited inside, away from the cameras, so President Nixon could, in effect, deliver his own tribute to Pat. Well, I'm standing there 20 feet away. On one side is Bob Dole, and on the other side is George McGovern, an improbable tableau. And Nixon gave this wonderful talk. And afterwards, reporters found out that Senator McGovern had been at the funeral. And they besieged him with questions. You know, why would you go and so on? And, you know, he said, well, I Mrs. Nixon and wanted to pay my respects. And of course, they weren't going to let it go at that. And he said, finally, when pressed, you know, why would you go and honor this man who, you know, dishonored you? And McGovern said the single classiest thing I've ever heard. He said, you can't keep campaigning forever. And you stop and think, if we could apply just a little bit of that to our politics today. But that, I think, helps to explain why in his later years, like Humphrey, in a sense. They were different temperamentally, but why they became sort of beloved figures. And certainly Senator Dole and Senator McGovern, I think, became even closer than Dole and Humphrey.
Yeah, absolutely.
I mean, he was here, I know, on at least one occasion.
He was here the very first week that I took over as director of the Dole Institute. He received the Dole Leadership Prize, and I will remember to my dying day him standing up and saying, "Well, all of you know the new director of the Dole Institute is Bill Lacey. I can't imagine that Bill Lacey toiled for Republican candidates for 20 years only to come here and give George McGovern an award at his first official event." And it brought down the lead center, and boy, I won't forget that. But let's go on to our final subject of the series.
Yeah.
Somebody that everybody here knows of pretty
yeah.
well.
Yeah.
And rather than, you know, doing the traditional biography
sure.
of Bob Dole, talk about some things that you know about Bob Dole that people here may not know about him.
Well, to revert to the to a Nixon funeral, it's interesting. I think you probably know much better than most. There was a time when Senator Dole had a reputation as a slashing partisan. And he had, fortunately, beginning in 1980, when he became chairman of the Finance Committee, he was given the opportunities to disprove that and to be a constructive, responsible legislator. And to his credit, obviously, he seized those opportunities. Richard Nixon never did an uncalculated thing in his life. And that included, certainly, planning his funeral and Mrs. Nixon's funeral. Now, Bob Dole was Nixon's candidate for 1996. In fact, Bob Dole and Pete Wilson, the governor of California, were his candidates. I remember I used to walk into the senator's office, and he'd say, "Well, I heard from your pen pal." And he'd open this great big drawer on his desk, and it was full of handwritten letters from Richard Nixon. And of course, they were the most grossly flattering. I mean, it's just what a master politician says to another master politician. Fortunately, the reason that they're master politicians is that they know that they're both shoveling the Anyway, but they have their own language. All right, and in any event, and I always thought it made no sense on the surface. Remember, Dole was fired very publicly and humiliatingly as Republican National Chairman in the wake of the 72 Nixon landslide. And anyone else would have held that against Nixon. And Dole never did. And I always thought Dole saw in Nixon that same sort of hard scrabble, up from the bootstraps kind of approach to life and to politics. I would argue, frankly, Senator Dole had more character, arguably, and certainly more honesty when it counted. But there was clearly an emotional connection there. And Nixon saw in Dole, I think, maybe a younger version of himself, scrappy, partisan, unappreciated, by the establishment, et cetera, et cetera. Anyway, when Mrs. Nixon died, there were four eulogists at her funeral. Two of them were Bob Dole and Pete Wilson, which really made no sense. Pete Wilson had been an advance man on the 1962 Nixon for governor campaign, something which he was inclined otherwise to forget as much as he could. But he wanted to showcase his candidates. Okay. But here's the acid test. The president himself died the following April. And I think he would tell you, I'm not telling you anything out of school, I wrote the eulogy that he delivered. And I knew, and I will go to my grave knowing it, Richard Nixon knew, because he knew Bob Dole. And he knew that Bob Dole would not be able to get all the way through a truly moving eulogy without breaking down. He knew it. He knew what buttons to push. And I was pushing him there for him, you know? So sure enough, I was sitting there in the crowd, and I could see, if you remember, all the presidents were there, and they'd all lined up in order, and the eulogists, who included Henry Kissinger, Bill Clinton, Bob Dole, and Pete Wilson, once again. And when the door opened and I saw the look on Elizabeth's face, I knew. I mean, I just knew what was going to happen, because it was pretty grim. And it was grim not only because of the occasion, but because she knew what he was going through. And he got up and he delivered the speech, and he delivered it beautifully. And at the end, he broke down. And which is exactly what Nixon wanted him to do, because he knew that 33 million people watched the funeral. And of those, I'll bet you 32 million were astonished to discover that Bob Dole had human emotions. And don't tell me it wasn't part of Richard Nixon's last will and testament to the American people to give Bob Dole the best possible platform from which to tackle his old image.
Richard, was the 74 Senate campaign against Bill Roy the crux of Bob Dole's career?
Yeah, it really was. I think, again, I don't want to speak for him, but I think there were things about that campaign that he wasn't terribly proud of. You know, he did what he needed to do to win. And the best evidence of that was, I know in later years, he made, I think, a good faith effort to befriend Dr. Roy. And I think he saw also, belatedly, he saw the price he had paid for excessive loyalty to his president, to his party, to an ideology. And, you know, he came within a hair's breadth of losing. And I think it was a wake-up call in a lot of ways. But then, lots of people go through situations like that. His great good fortune was then, as I say, to be given the opportunity a few years later with the Reagan victory to demonstrate what he could do, how he could work with people across the aisle, how he could be a constructive legislator and a potential president. And I think the story of growth, I mean, I think there really is, you know, that's a significant part of the Dole story.
Talk a little bit about the 88 and 96 presidential campaigns.
I tell you,
was 88 his main chance?
Yeah, he said, and not talking out of school here, I'm sure he said it publicly, but he has said that he never should have run in 96, that 88 was his chance. And in retrospect, I think he was right. Look, 96, you know, if people were almost handing it to you on a platter, and this is, you know, you wanted it all your life, you know, you're not going to walk away from it. But he also knew even then what he was up against: a popular president, a booming economy, splits within the party. It is no secret that he and Newt Gingrich were not best buddies. They certainly were not tactically as one. Remember the first government shutdown. That wasn't Bob Dole's style. And he went along with it to a point, and then he said, forget it. We're, you know, it's time for the grown-ups to come back into play and get things going. And you know, and I think it's safe to say that his relations with Gingrich have never fully recovered. But 88, you know, it's remarkable. People forget, not only did he defeat a sitting vice president in the Iowa caucuses, but of course Pat Robertson came in second. So George H.W. Bush finished third in Iowa. And remember, it was Iowa that Bush had won against Ronald Reagan, you know, 8 years earlier. So it was all the more stinging. If Bob Dole had won New Hampshire, then I think this would be the Dole Presidential Library. But over the weekend, there was, first of all, a snowstorm. And while George H.W. Bush could get out there and run snow plows, Bob Dole couldn't run a snow plow. But more to the point, Dole's pollster was telling him on Thursday, you're going to be president of the United States. And I think unusually, I don't think he believed it, but he let his guard down. And what happened over the weekend was Governor Sununu of New Hampshire, who was a real gut puncher, came up with an ad, famous ad called Senator Straddle. And it suggested that Dole couldn't be trusted, in effect, to cut taxes or to defend the Reagan tax cuts. And it literally involved Sununu going around to the television station in New Hampshire, opening them on the weekend, getting them this ad and running it. And there's a famous scene where future president and Mrs. Bush and Sununu are deciding, is this below the belt? And it was decided, no, you do what you've got to do to win. And they did. And almost overnight, it slipped away. And then, of course, Dole made it. It's only Dole could. Made it infinitely worse on TV by speaking his mind and telling...
on the evening of the New Hampshire primary on live TV.
On live TV, when Tom Brokaw had George H.W. Bush, said, do you have anything to say to the vice president? He said, yeah, I tell him to stop lying about my record. Now, here's the problem with that, okay? We all say we want our candidates to be honest and level with us and tell us what they really think until they do. That's why I say Harry Truman couldn't get elected dog catcher in the hypocritical media culture of the day, precisely because he was as honest and blunt as he was inclined to be. I always thought there was a Truman-esque quality in Dole, a kind of plain-spoken Midwestern. You know, people often ask, what kind of president would he have been? He would have been an unusual kind of president. He would have spent as much time, I think, down on Capitol Hill as he did in the White House. I think he would have seen almost it as an extension of his job on the Hill. I think he would have been very much a hands-on, you know, sleeves rolled up kind of legislator president. I remember him telling me once, God, if I ever become president, we're not having any black tie dinners, because it took him forever to get dressed, you know, to put on all those little buttons and everything. God. And that's as good a reason as any to do away with those horrible affairs. But that was the one, I think, concession he made. But I think he would have been, I think people would have found him refreshing. I always said to him, make age an advantage. Tell people up front that you're only going to run for one term. Because for a president to do the difficult things that are necessary, the last thing he should be thinking about is reelection. And in fact, he should tell himself up front, it's more important that I run the political risks of doing this and this and this, tackling the deficit, et cetera, and let the chips fall where they may. But if you said up front, like James K. Polk and Rutherford B. Hayes and almost no one else, up front that you were going to be a one-term president, then you turn the age issue from a liability into an asset. And you made credible the portrayal of you as a reform president. The reason you're running for president, I mean, I am the ultimate insider, and therefore I know how to fix what's wrong. It's like Richard Nixon being the ultimate anti-communist who went to China. He didn't take my advice.
Yeah. Bob Dole's legacy is going to be on his leadership, Republican leadership in the Senate. He remains to this day, I believe, the longest running Republican leader. It's going to be surpassed most likely by Senator McConnell, but to this day he is. And also his legislative accomplishments, whether in civil rights, Americans with Disabilities Act, yeah. Nutrition, all of those things.
And again, after he left office, there wouldn't be a World War II memorial if it wasn't for Bob Dole. But it's how he went about it. Bill Clinton invited him down right before his second inaugural. And of course, you know, it must have been a painful, in some ways, experience, because he was hoping it would be his inaugural. But he gave him the Medal of Freedom. Now, being Bill Clinton, he didn't give him without asking in return. So he said, let me show you. Well, anyway, in the East Room, they'd set up a model of the projected World War II memorial. And before they were done that day, he basically had Dole's agreement to be responsible for raising $100 million plus. And Dole hates to raise money, hates it. In fact, this institution would be better endowed if he were more willing to get on the phone and ask people for money. But he raised over $100 million. And not only that, then he, you know, there were people who were unhappy with the memorial. They didn't like the design. They didn't like the location. And typical Dole, they came up with a pressure group called Save the Mall. You know, and there was this woman who became the face of architectural purity. And Dole goes on TV, I think it was Larry King, he said, save them all, we already did it once. It was called World War II. That's Bob Dole. So in the end, he had the last word and the memorial, you know? But I mean, that's just one. Remember after 9/11, when Bob Dole and Bill Clinton teamed up to raise, again, I think over $100 million for the families of freedom, you know, to put the children, the orphans, in effect of 9/11 through school. I mean, it's really remarkable. And to this day, he's the 101st senator. He's a senator for veterans. You know, writing has never come easy, but he gets calls and letters every day from veterans who were, and others, but particularly from veterans who've run up against a bureaucratic wall. And he'll write out a response. And he's got someone on the staff, he's a poor Ruth Ann, she's the only one who could read my writing. But basically, and he'll make phone calls. And I mean, that's who he's lobbying for. He's lobbying for his fellow vets. And I know he has said that when the time comes, the one word he wants on his tombstone is veteran. He's very fortunate. Time has been good to Bob Dole. He became, in many ways, the face of the greatest generation. But he also became sort of this hip grandfather. I mean, anyone who saw the Pepsi commercials or the Viagra commercials or God knows what other commercials, you know, Bob, they don't think of Bob Dole as a legislator or candidate for president, you know? You know, he's the guy who went to Russell and everyone recognized him, but they wanted his Visa card.
Okay. I have one other question, then we'll open it up. As I said, very complex subjects tonight, so I'm sure everybody will have questions, but we'll open that up after my final question. Now, I wasn't going to ask this until I got an email from Tyler Holmes, who some of you may have met last night, who is a practicing lawyer in Kansas City, a corporate lawyer, who was on our student advisory board. And he said, you know, I've got a great question for you to conclude the whole series. And by golly, it was a pretty good question, so I'm going to ask it and credit Tyler. He mentioned the musical production that's really big on Broadway called Hamilton now, which is about Alexander Hamilton.
Yeah.
And he wanted me to ask you, if you had to pick one of the contenders we've discussed in this four-part series for a Broadway musical like that, who would you pick and why?
First of all, you have to appreciate the fact I don't appreciate hip-hop, and therefore, everyone assumes that I love Hamilton. I like Hamilton, but I'm not sure I'd like Hamilton. So I'm afraid I'm not a very good person to ask. Whose life has the drama and, you know, that would lend itself to a great sort of musical? Well, I'm biased. I'll go with Tom Dewey. Well, because first you've got all those gangsters. Can't you see the chorus line with the gangsters and the prostitutes and all the other characters that you know, that his gangbuster he was prosecuting, and certainly Bob Taft would make a worthy adversary in music and dance, and my God, election night 1948 could be a dirge. No, I think I'll go with Tom Dewey.
Okay, that's a good answer. We're going to open it up to your questions now. If you have a question, raise your hand. Get Eric or Jesse's attention over here. So we don't have any questions. Okay, we have a question right here, Jesse.
You mentioned the Dole Institute of Politics at the University of Kansas. I'm wondering if the other two have similar institutions.
That's a great question. I had this same conversation with Senator Dole, Senator Baker, whose center is at the University of Tennessee, and Senator McGovern, who has a center at Dakota Wesleyan. And in all three cases, they were assured by the universities that it would be a great honor to have their papers and their posterity, and don't worry about fundraising. They would, and of course, in all three cases, they discovered that they were their fundraisers, you know, for their institutions. But yeah, then there was a Humphrey Institute, which I think sort of fell on hard times. I think has been resurrected to some degree, but again, it's not just because we're here. There are a number of congressional centers around the country. None of them come close to matching this one, either in the facility or, more important, in the programming. You can understand, they tend to be seen, fairly or not, as vanity projects to some degree, with a short lifespan. Once their namesake is gone, you know, it's tough to find a constituency. But anyway, this place stands out.
I would also add, if I might, and we'll go over here for a question. Some of you may recall, some of you who may have attended our 2008 post-election conference may have met a gentleman who was the deputy campaign manager for, somebody might want to get their phone and turn it off, was a deputy campaign manager for President Obama's campaign, Steve Hildebrand. Steve Hildebrand was a longtime McGovern aide, and when Senator McGovern passed, our archive here prepared a display commemorating his service and had lots of photographs and text and all that. And Steve told me that what we did here on behalf of Senator McGovern's memorial surpassed what his institute did for him. So that might tell you something there. Jesse, we have a question here.
Of the people that you've talked about, which contributed most to society after they lost the election?
You know, it's hard to say. I don't mean to be evasive. Each in his own way. And what sort of depends on, I mean, Bob Dole and Senator McGovern together contributed, I think, enormously to fighting hunger on a global basis. I mean, it's in some ways they accomplished things that no United States senator alone, or even quite frankly, a president alone could do. I mean, they were part of a global effort, one that's ongoing. And so, I mean, it's, but gosh, you know, when you throw in all the other things that Senator Dole has done and continues to do, I mean, I guess I'm uncomfortable with having a competition, if you will. It seems to me that each got to do the things that they wanted to do and that were really kind of reflective of their interests and their talents. Senator Humphrey ran for president 2 more times. But he also taught in college, and he returned to the Senate. And, you know, became a kind of beloved figure, an icon, if you will, of a kind of politics that perhaps died with him. So, I don't know how you measure them. I think I would say they were all blessed, each in their own way. I mean, lots of people who run for president are cursed. Lots of people never get over it. Lots of people, it's almost a badge of shame. And Bob Dole, I remember, told me once after 88, you know, he had trouble sleeping sometimes. He had dreams about what he did wrong in the campaign. And then finally it came to him, he realized, anyway, he didn't know how long he was going to be around. And the last thing he was going to do was spend whatever time he had in second thoughts, you know, second guessing what might have been in the campaign, which of course is the only healthy attitude to take, but not everyone has that. So they were all, each in their own way. Obviously, you wish Senator Humphrey could have had a longer life, but you know, each in their own way lived a very fulfilling existence and demonstrated that there is life. As Humphrey said to Dole, this life after losing a national election.
Okay, I have a question here.
After your first talk about the 19th century losing candidates, you mentioned that all of the three of them knew the difference between the time for politics and a time for policy. It would seem, and I want your reaction, that most of these other candidates you've done in the last three speeches also knew that difference.
I think that's true. I mean, I think one of the real unfortunate developments of modern presidential politics is that we've erased the line between campaigning and governing. So we have what we call the permanent campaign. And a lot of it is in response to the perceived needs of the media. You know, we have a 24/7 news cycle. We have to feed it every day, which, by the way, helps to explain more than anything else the nature of the coverage of this campaign. Every 24 hours, you need a new twist in the story, a new kink in the narrative, and so you get the kind of coverage that you get. How early in the second Obama term did you detect a boredom on the part of much of the media with just covering the incumbent, and how much anticipation there was of the race to come? You know, John F. Kennedy declared his candidacy for presidency in January 1960. And that's considered a classic kind of campaign. It's just too long. It's too long. It's too wearing. It's too fill in the blank.
I have a question right here.
This is really kind of a follow-up to that question. Is you all of these people by the end of their career, you could tell, it would not be hard to see that in 20 years they would be highly thought of and that people respected them. Is there anyone in today's current environment that you've just described that you could pick out and say that's going to be a Humphrey, that's going to be a McGovern or a Dole? I'm just curious.
Well, there's a reason why presidents become more popular the further they're out of office. They're no longer partisan, polarizing, party leaders. They become elder statesmen, you know. And because they have successes for people to hate. I mean, they're quite frankly, attention turns to whoever succeeds them. And they become the object of public scorn. Or adulation, depending on where you are on the political spectrum, but ironically, presidents leave office at the nadir of their reputation, which means the only one place to go is up. But there are a whole host of factors contributing to the reasons why they go up, and is buyer's remorse. Sometimes it happens before they leave office. If you look at the Gerald Ford's approval rating the day before the 76 election and the day before he left office, it went up 20 points. Something almost dramatically, equally dramatic happened with George H.W. Bush. There are presidents who don't get reelected, and it makes perfect sense that they don't get reelected. But at the same time, people have mixed feelings. They feel badly, almost, about evicting them from office. And you knew over time that people would come to see Ford in a more generous light, and likewise, I would argue both President Bushes. And I'll predict that Barack Obama, whose ratings are higher than other recent presidents as we speak, will have still higher numbers out of office. Being president is a man-killing, reputation-crushing occupation. There's no way to avoid it. But once you cease to be president, people discover all sorts of hidden virtues and good intentions. And they compare your performance. Nostalgia is a wonderful thing. They compare your performance with whoever succeeded you. And all of a sudden, he wasn't so bad after all. And I think it's a good thing. It's a healthy thing. I hope it never ceases. I've told you the wonderful ultimate story about a presidential comeback when Herbert Hoover was asked not long before he died how he had survived the long period of ostracism when he was personally blamed by many for the Great Depression. And he said, it's simple, I outlived the bastards. There's the ultimate revenge is longevity.
Okay, you have a question here.
One of Bob Dole's greatest assets was his sense of humor. Of the other individuals you profiled last night and tonight, which one would you cite for having that quality?
They all had. And in fact, that raises a good point. Harry Truman said that a man without a sense of humor would go crazy in the presidency. And if you remember, one of Bob Dole's post-presidential activities was to write a book of presidential humor. And another was to rank all the presidents by their senses of humor. And not surprisingly, at the bottom you find Fillmore and Pierce and Buchanan and, you know, all of those losers, traditionally written off as losers for other reasons. It turns out they had no sense of humor. And people with a sense of humor, among other things, is a sense of perspective. If you can laugh at yourself, if you can laugh at your ambition, if you can laugh at the ambitious people around you, if you can laugh at the absurdities of the political world, that's a sign of mental health, if nothing else. And usually it's a sign of a positive outlook, a positive temperament. And one rule of the presidency is you're much more likely to succeed with a positive outlook, an activist outlook, if you will, than the opposite.
Okay. Do we have any other questions? Before we take any more questions, I want to recognize somebody here because he's a senior, it's his last program. Mr. Eric Pauls, who is over here, has been part of our SAB for 4 years, and he's been my research assistant for the last two or two and a half? Three. Yeah. And if you ever want somebody who can channel Bill Lacey's interview questions or anything like that, Eric Pauls is the man. So, Eric, thank you very much for your service. He did a great job for me. So, final questions for Richard. Be your last chance for a while. Okay. Richard, thanks for another great series
thank
at the Dole Institute. Thanks to all of you for braving the weather.
Absolutely.
We really appreciate it, and look forward to seeing you maybe around in the summertime. We'll have probably a couple of summer programs, but we have a huge fall lined up.
And huge. We'll be,
yes, huge. Thank you. And you'll be hearing about that sometime later this summer. So have a great summer. Thank you all for your support.